Hello everyone. Narcissist Free Almost here, and today is part 2 of 3 talking about perversions and perversity in the personality disordered according to Otto Kernberg and object relations theory. Starting off of the heels of last week, the more severely pathological level of perversion have a two-layer defensive organization, with Oedipal conflicts condensed with severe pre-Oedipal conflicts whose aggressive aspects dominate the clinical picture. These perversions are typically found in patients with borderline personality organization. In fact, the characteristic psychodynamics of borderline personality organization based on Kernberg's own psychotherapy research project at the Menninger Foundation in 1975, turned out to overlap dramatically with the dynamics of the severe level of perversion described by André Lussier in his study on fetishism. At this severe level of perversion appears two major personality organizations. Can you guess which two? I mentioned that for sure is a borderline, but you can add narcissistic personality organization to that mix, and that's no surprise really, is it? Now, in the ordinary borderline personality organization, that has a dominant reliance on splitting mechanisms affecting ego and superego, and a combination of sadistic and masochistic features in sexual behavior, as well as general character structure, this then reflects the abnormal metabolism of aggression. In other words, you have all the usual pathology going on combined with abnormally high levels of aggression, that, of course, they will deny, hide, and distract from. Keep in mind, this is Kernberg's running theme, that is, aggression, or rather primary aggression, that has never worked through in infancy and early childhood, because of their arrest in development, is transformed and then mutates into severe psychopathology. Then there is the second, the narcissistic personality structure, in which the perverse scenario is infiltrated by the aggressive aspects of the condensed Oedipal and pre-Oedipal conflicts. Going back for a second, to those two conflicts, recall that neither have been worked through by the pathological borderline and narcissist, so what's happened is that they blend together, then condense, or even ossify. Also imagine aggression that is being filtered through the mind of an infant or toddler. And many of us here have seen toddler temper tantrums and how explosive they can be. So you have that level of aggression, and its impulsive-like explosiveness just simmering under the surface of a borderline or narcissist. This is their internal frame of reference through which they filter information, and it's no wonder why their perceptions are distorted and skewed. According to Kernberg, in the case of malignant narcissism, the aggressive drive derivatives are integrated into the pathological grandiose self with consequent dangerous sadistic deteriorating of the perversion. In other words, because there is so much aggression, due to the conflicts and such, the malignant narcissist incorporates this into his grandiose self, and over time this aggression transformed and expressed in sadism will deteriorate, or get worse. In psychoanalytic literature concerning perversion, narcissistic features have been suggested as a general characteristic. So most psychologists and psychiatrists presently, when seeing a client with a perversion, would assume that their client would be a highly narcissistic case, if not a type of narcissist with all the corresponding personality structures. Therefore, according to Kernberg from a clinical perspective, it is extremely important to differentiate patients with narcissistic conflicts in a nonspecific sense, from those who have a narcissistic character structure. Obviously because of the prognostic and treatment implications. And here's where it gets a little bit tricky, something called zonal confusion, where the anal and oral regression is at this severe level of perversion. It is the symbolic equivalent of all protruding or invaginated sexual areas of both genders with corresponding condensation of oral, anal and genital strivings. I'm going to back up again and quickly review the oral, anal and genital stages of development, and what regression to these stages entail for the borderline and narcissist. Starting with the oral stage is from birth to about 18 months, where the main concern of the infant is with oral gratification. The anal stage is where the infant becomes fascinated with the processes of elimination, and this occurs around the ages of 1 to 3 years old. Fast forward to the genital stage beginning in puberty and is a time of adolescent sexual experimentation. A successful resolution would be settling down in a loving one-to-one relationship in our 20s. With these definitions, you can see here, Once again, condensation of stages as well as an overlapping of developmental stages that were never successfully worked through, prone to regression, and a revisiting of their old conflicts through their perversions. In other words, perversions are a direct reflection of someone with a severe pathology. With that understanding, unconscious anal fantasies dominate the sexual life of these patients with fecalization of genital organs and genital intercourse. Their anal sadistic aggression involves an attack on, and destruction of object relations, while the oral aggression is reflected in their oral sadistic expression of envy and destructive greed. The perversions of narcissistic personalities reveal the most dramatic combination of these dynamics. 1. The unconscious fantasy of a fecal penis and a fecal vagina. 2. The unconscious equalization of genders and ages. And I think it's important to notice this one here, as you can see how it relates to the perversion of pedophilia. 3. A primitive idealization of the perversion linked with the denial of castration. And, 4. The tendency to equalize all object relations and all sexual activities, which in the process becomes spoiled, digested and expelled as feces. Here, the perverse scenario may succeed in containing aggression, but the aggressive impulses overshadow libidinal ones, threatening to neutralize erotic excitement, and to corrode, or destroy the object relation. The defensive idealization of the perversion may express itself in a stress on the aesthetic qualities of both the sexual object and sexual scenario, reflecting both the defense against, and the expression of the image of fecalized sexual organs, and an illusory adaptation in the form of, as if, relationships. In closing, I hope you can see how aggression plays a dominant role in, not only pathology in general, but in severe sexual perversions as well, which are the result of the severe pathology. You can see how these perversions make perfect sense when you look back into the stages of infant and early childhood development. Acting out these perversions is merely a regression into stages of development that arrested for whatever reasons. Make no mistake, however, innocent they are not. With severe levels of aggression festering just under the surface makes them dangerous, and with conscious and unconscious pathologies, reason is absent, judgment is insubstantial, and narcissism prevails, making their needs and desires the only priority, thereby nullifying, in their own minds, the untold damage they do to others. In an era of so-called inclusiveness, where fringe groups, what would otherwise be called perversions, are making their way into politics and attempting to change laws, as well as trying to normalize their odd behavior, consider this series on perversions a cautionary tale. And remember, someone with a personality disorder isn't going to change, even for the best of reasons, but one thing's for sure, they will change you. And not in a good way. Well, that's it for this week, and if you found this content helpful, please give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and comment. You can find me on Facebook at NarcissistFreeAlmost, and on Instagram at Clumber_Lover. As always, sending you all my love and gratitude, and I do hope you're living peace of mind narcissist free. I know I am.